It seems like nowadays, us as content creators, whether we like it or not, are always chasing the cinematic look. And yeah, hey, look, I'm fully aware that that word's meaning has essentially become a meme at this point, but I'm not here to break down what makes a cinematic image. Instead, I want to talk to you guys about one characteristic that I think many of us are familiar with or have at least heard of, and that is anamorphic. Quick disclaimer, I'm by no means an expert on the topic. I know there's a lot of anamorphic purists out there, but for this, we're gonna keep things pretty surface level. For those of you who aren't familiar yet, let's take a little crash course. Essentially, anamorphic lenses capture a wider than normal field of view and squeeze the image horizontally onto the sensor. You then need to de-squeeze or stretch the image back out in post in order to make it look normal again. Sounds a bit confusing, I know, but simply put, when shooting with an anamorphic lens, you'll end up with a significantly wider field of view when compared to a normal spherical lens of the same focal length. The image stays the same vertically, you simply gain width on the sides of the image, which gives us that wide aspect ratio that we all love. You know, those black bars that you often see at the top and bottom of people's videos. Most of the time, people actually overlay those bars onto their image, or sometimes even export that video in that wide aspect ratio. But in both cases, you're actually losing resolution and cropping your image, like literally cutting off parts of your footage. As opposed to shooting with anamorphics, where the de-squeezed image actually becomes like true widescreen. Now, along with the increased field of view, there's a number of other things we get when shooting with these lenses. The most popular, of course, being the flares. Yes, those giant, beautiful blue-ass flares, ones you see in all of the big Hollywood blockbusters, you know, the giant blue streaks across the frame. I mean, like, come on, who can't love them? We also get a very distinct and unique looking bokeh shape. As you can see, the out of focus areas in the image take on kind of this like stretched vertical look. It's especially visible in the balls of light, and you just get these amazing looking oval shapes. And finally, anamorphic lenses tend to add just a lot of character or film-like imperfections into the image. Things like chromatic aberration, distortion, and like reduced sharpness. Generally, they're just kind of soft, especially in the edges of the frame. All of these things combined, and we end up with an image straight out of camera that basically just screams cinematic. Okay, anamorphic lenses are cool. Now what? Well, here's where it gets a little confusing. Traditionally, these lenses are expensive, like buy a car or two expensive. These things just really aren't accessible to the everyday shooter. Over time, there's been various more affordable options out there. Anamorphic adapters are a thing, like ones that screw onto the front of your lens, but they're tedious to use and the results are a little unpredictable. They're, I don't know, it's just a lot of moving parts. Enter Suray. Suray. They've created four sub $1,000 anamorphic lenses, a 24 millimeter, a 35, 50, and their brand new 75 millimeter. This opens up an entirely new class of options when you're looking to shoot anamorphic. So what does this mean for us? What kind of image can we get out of these budget anamorphic lenses? Well, here I have the 24 millimeter and the new 75 millimeter. Let's see what they're all about. Just to make things clear, Suray did send me these lenses for free to try out. However, they are not paying me to make this video, nor do they get to have any input or even see the video before it goes live for you guys. So let's go ahead and fire off some of the basic details. These lenses come in several mount options. There's a Micro Four Thirds, Sony E-mount, Fuji X mount, Canon EFM, as well as the Nikon Z mount. These things have APS-C coverage and you can use them on full frame, of course, with some cropping. I shot basically everything on these lenses with my Sony a7S III and used clear image zoom in camera. These are, of course, fully manual lenses. They're built like tanks. I mean, they're solid metal and they feel surprisingly premium. Like the focus and aperture rings honestly feel much higher quality than the price that you pay for these things. The 24mm f2.8 comes in at $999 and the new 75mm f1.8 will be available for $899. Now let's jump into the image quality, the thing I think most of you guys will probably end up just skipping to anyways. Overall, these things are really impressive, remarkably sharp, especially for anamorphic lenses. They're a 1.33 times squeeze factor, which is a bit less than many of the go-to anamorphics, usually ranging from around like 1.8 to 2x. Squeeze factor, again, meaning how much horizontal field of view is getting squished down onto the sensor. The greater the number, the wider the field of view that you'll end up with. Usually most people want the most squeeze factor possible when shooting anamorphic. It gives off the most, you know, anamorphic character, but that's not always a good thing. We'll talk more on that a little bit later. Like I mentioned earlier, I shot pretty much all of this footage on my Sony a7S III using clear image zoom in camera. The 24mm, you need to punch into around 1.4 or 1.5x to avoid any vignetting, especially if you're using an ND filter on the front of the lens. On the 75mm, I was able to shoot around 1.2x with just like really subtle vignetting. So in essence, I believe the 75mm has a little bit larger than Super 35 coverage, which is kind of impressive. Correct me if I'm wrong, somebody down in the comments. When shooting with these on the a7S III, even zoomed all the way into 1.5x with like the 24mm, the footage looks incredible, like absolutely detailed and sharp enough, in my opinion. I mean, especially for shooting with anamorphics where the image is gonna be kind of soft. But overall, even though these lenses aren't really designed to be used on full frame, they work surprisingly well. Color reproduction is fairly accurate. They look really pleasing. However, you'll notice in the side-by-sides when comparing them to my Tamron zooms, they're a lot warmer. I wouldn't necessarily say it's a bad thing. I kind of like the warmer image overall, but of course this is something that you can correct for in post, you know, no problem. The color is consistent between the two lenses, which is arguably one of the most important things when looking at a cinema glass. The distortion is really minimal, even with the 24mm, which is pretty impressive for such a wide anamorphic lens. The overall anamorphic character of these lenses is fairly what I would call like natural, soft chromatic aberration in the corners. The flares on the 24mm can get a little crazy at some times. The 75mm is much more desirable in my opinion when it comes to flaring. The oval bokeh with these guys is really cool. The 75mm, it's much, much more visible, just mainly due to it being a longer lens. So there's more compression. You can just see more of the actual anamorphic character in the lens. The 24mm still has some to it. I mean, it still has that nice vertical kind of stretched out of focus areas in the image. Like I said, these lenses are fully manual. So pulling focus while running around, you know, shooting handheld, you end up with a lot of soft shots. And honestly though, I gotta say, like I like the look of the soft shots. That anamorphic character just really makes these things fun to shoot with. The image you get, even when things are soft, like it's just overall a really pleasing look in my opinion. So, I mean, so far these lenses are pretty amazing, but I don't know. I feel like since I'm so new to anamorphic, it's a little easy to get kind of just overhyped on the idea as a whole. So let's talk about some of the downsides about these lenses. Well, kind of the whole point of anamorphics for a lot of people is to get those amazing big streaky flares. They can get kind of crazy sometimes with these guys. There's gonna be a lot of flares and they're pretty bright and pretty saturated, which a lot of people will probably end up liking. So it's not really that big of a deal. The 1.33 times squeeze factor with these lenses, A lot of people wish they could have been a little bit more, but in a way, this is actually good for some shooters. Reason being, when shooting with an anamorphic lens, framing and focusing your shot can be tough if you don't have a camera or a monitor that can de-squeeze that image on the screen. 1.33 isn't too squished or look too crazy and doesn't make it too hard if you're shooting without a monitor, which I think is a pretty common thing for a lot of people, especially those who might be in the market for these lenses. Since it's a manual lens, focus gears would be really nice. The interesting thing is the 35 millimeter out of this set actually comes with these little rubber slip-on ones. So it's a little confusing to me why Suray wouldn't just include the little focus rings for all of the lenses. Yeah, I mean, it would be really nice if they just came with them. It's sort of tough to really pick on these things too much. I mean, they're really a completely new class of lens. I feel like I'm kind of nitpicking on some of these points. If I had to describe it, they're more or less like the basic image quality and sharpness of like a low to mid-range photography lens, but you get the widescreen look, some cool oval bokeh, and of course, blue ass flares. But let's pull back for a second and answer the more important question. Should you buy these lenses? Or I guess, who are they for? They make anamorphic shooting accessible to pretty much anybody with a mirrorless camera. I mean, the size and weight and just overall ease of use of these things make them truly fun to shoot with. Anamorphic historically has been not only expensive, but bulky and cumbersome and just generally kind of complex. So these being, you know, basically the same size as any other photo lens, they just mount right up and they focus smooth. It's pretty nuts. They're an extremely interesting and fun way to add a really unique look and feel to your footage for a semi-affordable price. The 75 millimeter has a lot more of that anamorphic character. It certainly feels a lot more cinematic or film-like when shooting around. The 24 millimeter, on the other hand, isn't as like obviously anamorphic looking, but it's super fun for day-to-day kind of cinematic run and gun work. I think this would look really amazing thrown on a gimbal. I think between the two, if I had to pick just one, I'd probably end up going for the 75 millimeter just because I don't know. I'm in love with the look it creates. I mean, obviously that's entirely subjective. Again, they have four focal lengths to choose from. So I think what Suray has done by opening up an entirely new market of anamorphic lenses at such an incredible price point is really amazing. They've come up with a full set of anamorphic primes for APS-C in barely even 2 years. I'm extremely interested to see what they'll continue to do in the future. I mean, who knows, maybe EF mount, maybe full frame coverage, or I don't know. If you guys are interested in these things, definitely check them out at the links below. But with that being said, I'm gonna go ahead and wrap up the video here, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Be sure to give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you in the next video.